We have more on the controversial incident to AEW Revolution, and did AEW try to sign this top champion? But first, the AEW Revolution pay-per-view went down last night, a show that saw three long-lasting feuds seemingly come to an end. The event would open up with a match between Ricky Starks and Chris Jericho, with the Jericho Appreciation Society banned from ringside. And while Sammy Guevara did try to interfere before being cut off by Action Andretti, it was the young up-and-comer that got away with a huge win. In the end, Starks would secure his second win over the Ocho, this after he blocked a baseball bat shot and an attempted Judas effect before hitting the Rochambeau for the pinfall victory. This would then lead to the final burial match, which saw Christian Cage and Jungle Boy Jack Perry fight to put their opponent into the ground. The finish saw Jack battle his inner conscience when he finally delivered a brutal-looking concerto to knock Christian out, which allowed him to throw him into the casket before slamming the lid shut. It's also worth noting that there was no return for Luchasaurus, who is in the midst of a legal battle over the rights to his mask design, which is seemingly continuing to keep him off of television. And before we get to the championship bouts, let's find out who came out on top in the Texas Death Match between Jon Moxley and Hangman Page. After 26 minutes of barbed wire, bricks, and blood, it was Hangman that hung Moxley from the ropes by a chain, bringing the match to a close in fitting fashion, with him tapping out. The result evens the scores between the two men, with Moxley holding two wins over Page and vice versa, with them likely now set to go their separate ways. Now let's get to the first title match of the night, which saw the Elite put their AEW Trios Championship on the line against the House of Black in what turned out to be the only result that the final betting odds got wrong. After an action-packed back and forth, it was Malakai Black, Buddy Matthews, and Brody King that left with the gold, this after a Dante's Inferno dropped Matt Jackson, with Black scoring the pin. This is certainly an interesting booking decision given the recent talk of Kenny Omega's expiring contract, although only time will tell if that came into play in the decision to have the Elite lose the belts that were created for them. We would then see Jamie Hayter defend her AEW Women's World title against Saraya and Ruby Soho, which also saw Britt Baker and Toni Storm at ringside to support their respective partners. It was Hayter that left as still champion, securing a crucifix pin on Soho, although it was the aftermath that got people talking. After being caught in the middle of a faction war between the AEW originals and the outsiders, Ruby Soho finally made her mind up, turning heel after the match, attacking Hayter and Baker with Saraya and Toni's help. She would then spray paint both women with a green L to match her hair, with the originals now outnumbered in this continuing feud. The show would then see a second title change in the bout for the AEW TNT Championship, with Wardlow managing to kick off his second reign with the belt. The close of the match saw Wardlow take a page out of Joe's book, with him locking in a Kikina clutch, leading to the submission victory. This now means that we will see Wardlow make his first defense this Wednesday on AEW Dynamite against Face of the Revolution ladder match winner Powerhouse Hobbs, something that was confirmed on last night's broadcast before the two came face to face during the post-show media scrum. The AEW Tag Team titles were also on the line last night, which led to Austin and Colton Gunn retaining their belts in a four-way tag match against the teams of The Acclaimed, Jeff Jarrett and Jay Lethal, as well as Danhausen and Orange Cassidy. Much like the women's match, it was what happened after the bell that made the headlines, as the champs would take to the mic to celebrate their win, this before some familiar music filled the arena. FTR's Dax Harwood and Cash Wheeler would then make their return to the company after more than 2 months away from AEW television. The return comes after a lot of speculation over Dax and Cash's contract status and future in the company, this after it was recently revealed that their deals come to an end in April, this via Harwood's podcast. However, it appears that all this talk was in fact leaked for storyline purposes, with them securing long-term deals with AEW going forward, and PW Insider have noted. FTR returned to AEW tonight to set up a new program with AEW Tag Team Champions The Guns. As PWInsider.com has reported in the Elite section, the belief was that FTR are locked into long-term deals with AEW, and their disappearance and tease of going elsewhere was just a storyline cover. What's interesting from this is that AEW are willing to put out contract information that isn't necessarily accurate, something that is particularly worth noting following a recent report from Fightful Select that some in the business feel that MJF's deal no longer ends in January 2024, despite this being the crux of his current story arc and what he's been telling people off camera. With that said, this isn't necessarily confirmation of this being true or not, it's just something I thought that was worth mentioning. And speaking of the AEW World Champion MJF, last night's AEW Revolution pay-per-view saw him compete in the fight of his life against number one contender Bryan Danielson under 16-minute Iron Man rules, a true throwback to the American Dragon's days in Ring of Honor, a theme of Max's work in recent times. As the countdown clock got closer to zero, both men were tied at three falls each, this whilst MJF was locked in a LaBelle lock with seconds to go. Whilst the champion did tap out eventually, this happened only after the bell was called to end the match, meaning he retained as a result of a draw. However, AEW president Tony Khan would then send a message to the headset of commentator Tony Schiavone, with him asking for the match to be resumed under sudden death rules, a message that was passed on to the referee. After an extra 5 minutes that saw Danielson come close to victory, it was MJF that walked away with the win after striking the challenger with an oxygen tank that was left at ringside by medical staff outside of the referee's view before Max locked in a LaBelle lock of his own for the tap out win. This wasn't the end of the night for the world champion, however, as he would later appear as part of the post-show media scrum, with this looking very reminiscent to CM Punk's infamous all-out media scrum, towel and blood included, with pickles being Max's choice of snack rather than cupcakes. The nod followed a night of MJF constantly calling himself the best in the world, with him also making references to the pipe bomb during the scrum. Max would then once again pay tribute to Jim Cornette in his final words, closing with the line, "Thank you, you, bye." And before we get to the rest of today's stories, be sure to subscribe to Wrestle Planet if you haven't done so already, as we aim to hit 50,000 subscribers by the end of the year. And also head over to Wrestle Planet Gaming if you're into wrestling video games, ahead of the launch of both AEW Fight Forever and WWE 2K23. But with that said, let's get to the rest of the video. Now let's get to some news regarding All Elite Wrestling's next pay-per-view, Double or Nothing. During the Revolution broadcast, the date and the location for the event was confirmed, with AEW set to return to Las Vegas for the entirety of Double or Nothing week. Firstly, AEW Dynamite will go live on Wednesday 24th from the MGM Grand Arena, the same place a live edition of Rampage will air on Friday, May 26th. The week will then close with the Double or Nothing pay-per-view itself on Sunday, May 28th, which will be held down the road at the T-Mobile Arena for the second year in a row. Earlier today, New Japan Pro Wrestling would celebrate their 51st anniversary with an event in the Ota City Gymnasium in Tokyo, where a new member of the Bullet Club was revealed. During his win over Tomohiro Ishii in the first round of the New Japan Cup, David Finlay, son of Fit Finlay, would be joined at ringside by Gedo, the former manager of Jay White, confirming that he is Switchblade's replacement in the popular faction. It was in fact Finlay that sent White packing from New Japan, as after his Loser Leaves New Japan loss to AEW's Eddie Kingston, Jay would be attacked by David, foreshadowing his future in the Bullet Club. Whilst it's unclear if he will take over as leader, BC's newest addition moves on to the second round of the New Japan Cup, with him set to battle Great Okan on March 15th. Next, we have yet another story concerning MJF, who would get the internet talking with a controversial fan interaction during the early stages of the Iron Man match main event. Whilst dodging Bryan Danielson at ringside, Max would make his way into the crowd with him mouthing off to fans and throwing trash at them. He would then take a drink from a woman's hand before throwing it on her kid, who was sat next to her. It was believed at first that the liquid was just water, however it was later revealed by Brian Alvarez of Wrestling Observer that it was in fact tequila, some of which went in the boy's eye, with him being upset at the incident. Sean Ross Sapp of Fightful would then dispel talk of the kid being a plant, with him taking to Twitter to say, "It seems like the kid MJF threw the drink on wasn't a plant. He was very upset." Fightful's Will Washington went and got him an acclaimed foam finger. Some others from AEW talked to the child to help smooth things over. Amanda Huber is sitting with him now. An image of the kid would later appear on social media, with him being invited backstage to make good for the incident, with him being pictured with Powerhouse Hobbs. It looks like AEW were quick to step in and make up for the drink spot, not only to send the boy home happy, but likely to soften the chances of any future legal action. Now we go back to the AEW Revolution media scrum, where AEW president Tony Khan was asked about current IWGP Women's Champion Mercedes Moné, the former Sasha Banks. Khan would be asked about past teases that Mercedes was set to debut in AEW earlier this year, specifically the Boss reference from Britt Baker heading into the tag match involving a mystery partner. Whilst Tony refused to comment on if he and Moné had talks about her coming in, with a no comment perhaps being telling in itself, he would state that he has respect for the Women's Champion of New Japan Pro Wrestling, and he would say, Well, I have a ton of respect for the IWGP Women's World Champion. I wouldn't want to comment on discussions I've had with any wrestler as a free agent, in particular, a wrestler who's a champion of one of our partners. I have a ton of respect for that great wrestler, and that's somebody any wrestling company would be very fortunate to have wrestling for them. And before you go, make sure you check out 10 more upcoming wrestling free agents that you need to know.